When we were about 14, they used to have the afternoon dances at the Empress Hall, which is where they go the all-nighters were, when later on. We used to go dancing there on Saturday night. As I said before, a man named Farriman used to run it. And it used to get very packed. I mean very, very packed. You'd a job to dance sometimes, it was that bad. But they all had their own style of dancing. I was quite a decent dancer, maybe a bit too decent, but I'll leave that alone too. You could get into a place on the balcony, into an adjacent room. That was a smaller dance hall, and that was a bit more sedate for sedate people. That's where we went, usually. Then there was another place, the Court Hall. Well, that was a different type. That was supposed to be a little bit upmarket for the Empress. But a lot of the old boys used to frequent that, you know. And they were a pretty rough lot too.
What was the Empress Ballroom like?
Oh, that was terrific, I thought. It was. I used to go for it every Saturday, and it was unlicensed. You couldn't get a drink there on Saturdays, but on Friday night, the late news were called the late night dances. I think they went on to about 12:30, which was late then, maybe sometimes 1:00. And they did have a bar, but they circumvented the licensing laws by saying that they were like St Patrick's Ball, that the policemen somewhere they could get an occasional license. And I think it became the casino about 1967, 68, something, somewhere in that order. But there were three ballrooms in Wigan at that time. There was the Empress Ballroom, the Court Ballroom, and the Court School of Dancing.
We used to do the dancing like they did before, the quick step, the waltz. They have some disc today, various discs, don't they, about dances. You used to make your own dancing up too, we did. The movements that you made didn't always represent the ones that went in the style. You went according to the movement and the way that your body went, the way you felt like. All this business where you twirling round and round like, you know, the girl, it's nothing new then. It's all been done before, everything. A lot of people, it's old fashioned then, but it's not. No, there's always a section that's different and better. And you needed to be fit to do it.
Where did they go to dance?
Well, all the clubs. You know, we went there to all the clubs that I've just said. But really, dancing was Wigan Casino. And then, of course, later was Northern Soul. And that really hit big. Probably put Wigan on the map with regards to clubs and things, you know, the scene there. And I went to that a few times, but I was in my career then, so I moved away a bit from Wigan. But that was a massive thing in the 70s with Northern Soul. Yeah, it was a big deal, that.
That was where I met my wife, at the Sportsman's Club. There was always the resident group called the Sportsmen, who were a pretty good group, and they'd always have another group from out of town. And you just go there, dancing. It was just the dancing, really. Just the bopping and just dancing and meeting the girls. I mean, that was I should think the majority, I'd say 80% of the people in Wigan met their prospective wives or boyfriends at a club. Because none of this social media now, if you wanted a date with a girl, you contact them and say, none of that. If a girl was dancing, there were usually two of her and her friend, and you'd say to your friend, I fancy her. And you'd say, oh, well, come on with me. Well, I don't fancy your friend, just come on with me. So you'd go on dancing, and then if after the first dance, they said, oh, thank you, well, that was it, you got fired off. But if you got another dance, you think, oh, I've cracked it here. But the only problem was, if she fancied you and you fancied her, if her friend didn't fancy your mate or he didn't fancy her, you were snooker, because if she wouldn't leave her friend, they never left each other. If her friend went off, she'd go off. He wasn't on the phone to, I mean, now, I know for these young ones, that they sat in court and that continually he contacting them all day. Then we didn't have telephones at home. We didn't have a phone in our house. So if you saw a girl, you'd say, I'll meet you next, if you saw her on a Saturday, say, right, I'll meet you Tuesday. You'd arrange to meet her primarily on Woolley's Corner. That was a big meeting place, Woolworth's Corner. I don't know if you've seen that article I did about having a date. Nicky's got it, haven't you? Yeah, it tells you about what happened when you had a date. So, yeah, you'd just meet her there and then you'd see her. And then that was Tuesday and you'd say, oh, well, I'll see you Friday, I'll see you Saturday. And so you wasn't in each other's pockets all the time. You probably only saw her three or four times a week. And there's no way of getting in touch with them unless you worked. I mean, some people work with them, so it wasn't too bad. Or they lived near them. But a lot of people, they lived the other side of Wigan, so you'd never see them till the next date. And it was just, it wasn't a drinking culture as such, not like now in King Street. The thing was, you went out, you had a dance, you might have a couple of drinks, and that was it. You went home. Last buzz from Wigan, 11 o'clock. In Wigan, somebody would blow the whistle. Buzz would go. That was it. And where I lived, at Pemberton, it was 10 shillings for a taxi, 50p. But no way could I afford 10 shillings. So you'd walk it home, you'd see scores of people walking it because they missed the last buzz. No way would you get a taxi home. Especially if you're with a girl and she lived the other end of Wigan and you had to walk her home, or go home with her, see her home. And then sometimes I've walked it from Ince up to Pemberton. But you never thought anything about it. That was it. That's what you did.
Was there any popular dances you can remember?
It was bopping, really. And then there was the Ippy Ippy Shake. Twist again. We were about twisting.
Can you describe them?
Do you want to be... Okay. I can't do it now. I could do it then. It was chubby checking it. You want to Google all these things, twisting, and you start having, let's twist again, and you go like we did last summer, and you go down like that, and then go up, and then you go round and round and up and down we go again. Baby, this is don't let me know again, let's twist again. But we're a lot, didn't have all this weight on them, we're a bit more. That was one of the bits. And then there was other dances which, what else did we do? No, that was it. It was just bopping, really. So you know what bopping is, don't you? Just bopping.
How did people learn to dance?
You just picked, a lot of the girls dance with their friends. The girls were always better dancers than the boys because they used to, my wife said she used to practice at home in front of the mirror, and when a friend come round, they'd bop it. The girls were always better dancers, but I met a girl who I worked with. She wasn't a girlfriend as such, but when I used to go to the Empress, which was the casino, on a Saturday, I used to always meet her when I wasn't courting. I used to dance with her, and she was the only one I could dance with, really. My wife says she can't dance with me. She said, I'm a terrible dancer. But I could dance because she taught me how to dance. He just picked it up. I mean, some guys were really good dancers. They had all the footsteps. You just shuffle around. You just make it up as you go along. But it was primarily bopping. I mean, ballroom dancing had gone by then. That was in the 40s. It was the Americans who brought the bopping over, jitterbugging.
What is your favourite Wigan memory?
Wigan memory, rugby, they were the best side in the world, and music and all the kind of stuff that I've said to you, just all into one, is just makes Wigan for me, really.
Do you have a favourite era or decade of your life?
You know, I look back growing up with, I was very lucky. We lived in a normal terraced house, but I had a fantastic mum and dad and sister, and we grew up so well together. It was just an ordinary upbringing, but you know, we were so close and so together, and we did so much stuff. And my sister today, you know, she's not too well, but you know, we talk about music and our lifestyles and what we do all the time. But I tell you, it's not all about the past. The future is massive. And even now at my age, you know, you guys here, young people in the youth zone, this place is so fantastic. And I've just joined up here as a volunteer, and I'm so excited about it. So come on, I'm looking forward to the future as well.